prepared a few things just as an overview, because I had a discussion with Bremner as to what to talk about. So I'm going to just run through things that are in the upcoming development release series, because people are going to ask questions and the answer may often be, we already have that, but it's not really in the state release series yet. So in no particular order, the support for a newer version of Unicode, Unicode 8 instead of 5.2, which previous stable release series has. The current policy is to stay on the same version of Unicode in the stable release series, because it does affect the generation terms, and you want your queries to match your terms. C++ 11 is now a requirement for building it. There's not much C++ explicit 11 explicit support in the API yet. But now we require it, it's much easier to add. Query objects are now smaller, faster, and there are a few cases where the order n squared may no longer should be anything introspective. There's explicit support for geospatial searching, so limiting a search to a geographical area, finding things within a certain distance of somewhere. Database checking now gives less cryptic errors as available as an API and as a fix mode, so if you have a broken database, for some things it can have around, although a fairly limited number. It can mostly fix, if you run BTRFS on a server and it crashes, it tends to lose small files or empty them. You can fix that. There are new standards for Armenian, Basque, Catalan, and English. The support for giving prefetching hints to a database, if you're giving a search against a cold database, it can see which blocks it needs to prefetch before it can really get going. Send a prefetch into those and speed up the search quite a bit. There's some new weighting schemes, TF-IDF, some divergence and randomness schemes, which is a mathematical model based on some language model, which is a mathematical model. Replication change sets are now compressed on disk and on. There's a class for generating snippets, which is for little search things. The API for opening databases is being reworked. It's now flag-based rather than having a different method for opening a database in each database. For more optimizations for matching, which means faster searches. There's a new class for query parser for the build process. So you can say, so it looks at text that starts with some text and a colon, and then it passes the rest of it to a field process that's hooked up to that. So for example, you can set up a ROC 13 colon something, and then search that text, ROC 13, and lots of things you'd like to do with that in March.
Yeah, I think particularly date parsing.
So that's not completely finalised exactly how that's a value range.
It's already broken that.
Because value range is allowing you to say something dot dot something that turns into a range. Which is obviously kind of similar because the value ranges often have a something colon prefix on them.
Just trying to close
I think that probably wants to be unified or something. There's a new backend called Glass, which has the old backends would store which blocks one used in a bitmap, and those bitmaps ordering those base files. So each time a new revision is committed, you need to write to base file, which is based on the bitmap for the whole database. That's potentially quite a lot of data. Now it just stores free lists, and free lists are stored in the blocks of the database which otherwise be unused, so they essentially take up no extra space. And there's just one small file for the database which says where the read block for each table is and when free list starts.
So I don't know how you want to, do you want to take questions now or, I mean.
I've got a couple more things to talk about. But yeah, I'll take questions after that.
Sure.
This wildcard should work faster. The Glass reference counts as cursors. And the slope, one of the slopes is in a wildcard is that each term wildcard expands to creates a cursor. So that I share in blocks. Most of them, all the blocks are possibly the same. And there's also an operator for wildcards, so they're expanded later in the process. And again, that makes it more efficient. And that's it on the C++ API. The bindings, we have Python 3 support, PHP iterators, PHP typings, and Java are now generated by a suite, which means that the API should be up to date more. And that's my list. Don't worry if you didn't take all that in.
Yeah, there was a lot.
Good information, Tom.
So, one thing that we talked about.
Ja, wirklich wollten wir da nicht. Ich weiß nicht, ob das auf dem Boden da irgendwas eingeklemmt ist oder. Kann ich auch schon gut.
Oh! Also, der Geld machen wir es mit Gewalt. Okay. Ne,
Ah, der Boden ist nicht richtig
zu sagen. Ja,
gut, das war schon.
Ja,
okay.
Das macht
das gerade. So, you mentioned that Compat will become in place. Is that part of this development series, or it's planned
it's not
for the future?
Yet. I'd quite like to get it done with this one.
Okay.
So at the moment, the Compat today space essentially makes a copy, which is called each statement to add a free write sip, such that there's no waste of space. What I'd like to do is to be able to write the database back into the same directory in place. Which is much easier with Glass because it's tracking the position, a single file pointing to it, so a single file can say what the table name is as well. So we can write a new table under a different name and then delete the old one.
I guess the other user request that we've had that seems like quite a bit of work to deal with on the not much side is accent agnostic search. So you probably have discussed this with various people too.
Some of the stemmers already do that.
Okay.
I mean, whether it makes sense is to some extent language specific.
Right. So, and when do you have to decide this? At index time, or how does?
If you're setting a stemmer.
Yes.
Then you're setting that at index time. You also set it at search time.
Okay.
But for example, there's two variants of the German stemmer, one of which normalizes all nouns.
So for us, unfortunately, most people's email is a mix. Well, if you're either American and it's all English,
yeah.
or it's a mix of English and other languages.
I mean, if you're predominantly English, then probably what you want to do is to strip all the accents because you don't really understand them.
Yeah, that's right.
It's easier to search without the accents because your keyboard doesn't find a nice way to type.
So the English, does the English stemmers?
The English stemmer assumes English text, but it could quite easily be made to strip accents.
Yeah,
so I think you might need a custom stemmer for that.
Yeah. Can you, is that hard to write?
You can write your own stemmer quite easily.
Okay.
It's just essentially you provide a class to make this one function.
Doesn't sound so bad.
There's a library called UNAC, which I think is quite popular.
It would be strange if I'm the only one that has questions, but
that's not right.
There
was something else we discussed the other day that wasn't about database modified error.
Yeah, so the general concurrency model and snapshot isolation, I guess.
So realistically, it's actually unlikely to move away from single writer anytime soon,
mm-hmm.
because that's very hard to fundamental change. But at the moment, the way it works is you can have any number of readers and one writer, but when a writer commits a revision, the readers are checking each block they read to see if it's still valid for the revision they're reading. And if they hit a block that's been overwritten by the writer, you get a database modified error, and the idea is at that point you catch that and retry the search.
Right.
And to be honest, it's a pain in the ass. I mean, nobody really wants to have to do that. The way Glass is heading is that it will allow the reader to lock the revision they're on And so what you'll have is you'll have several old revisions being kept around.
So it's snap, reader snapshot.
Essentially, yes. Yeah. So like a VCC.
Yeah, that works pretty well.
I mean, the downside of it is the readers will have to log. And that's a bit of overhead.
You mean in the sense that they'll just keep the old data around until they're finished, right? Or until you
well, they'll have to take out a lock on the file, so they'll have to call FCMTL with it. So, because the writer needs to know not to discard those.
Oh, I see. So the writer's the one in charge of discarding. It's not, it's not like a GC layer or something.
Yeah. No, because there's no server.
Right, right. Well, I mean, yeah, you could have a function that.
Sorry?
You could have a function that did the GC that you deal with every now and then. But yeah, I understand.
I see.
The writer's the one that has to know it can't get rid of that right now.
Yeah, so I mean, there's the issue that a reader could store and just end up with a very old revision locked in a database within Lunin size.
Or that somebody might want to do that.
Yes, I mean, it's not possible to tell abuse from accident from intent.
I think you'll have to have some
but,
way.
I mean,
but by default, yeah.
Around. So there's some things that have made that easier. One is that, so the semantics of FCMTL locking are slightly insane for historical reasons. And if you close any file descriptor in the process on a locked file, the lock is discarded, which means that if something else in your process opens and closes the lock file, which people have managed to do this not much by having their database directory in their mail store, and the crawling of the mail store then reads the lock file to see if it's a mail, and closes it again, and that breaks your lock. So what's happened is done for a long time is it spawns a child process solely to hold the lock. So as well as the locking overhead, you get the rather greater overhead of fork. And then you might have noticed if you look in the process list that you have cat processes for a sub-process. So what it does is it forks and then it execs cat, because cat has exactly the semantics we want. It will simply listen forever, and if you send it in the file, it'll exit. So there's a relatively new in Linux variant on FCMTL locks called open file description locks. And they have the semantics which anybody who hasn't actually read the man page in detail assumes that FCMTL locks will have. And it's been passed to POSIX to standardization. And there's at least talk about adding it to FreeBSD and other operating systems. And Zappin supported that in the stable releases to political on that.
So does that mean?
So that means that reader locks will be less expensive than they would have been before we had the ability to do that.
I forget what the current state though is. That means also implications for NFS, like don't have your Zapier database on an NFS, because there's the whole dot locking issue.
So I wouldn't generally recommend you run it.
Right. I was just curious. Like, I'm happy with don't do that.
Yeah. For so me. If you run LockD, theoretically FCMTL locking works. I don't know how many locks LockD work. I suspect probably they fail, in which case they have to fall back to creating a child process. But I've never been entirely sold on NFS and LockD being bomb-proof.
Sure.
But if you want to run it on a different server, you're probably best running remote protocol. But the thing about the freelist implementation is all we need to do is kind of put a barrier in the freelist and say, don't release past this point, because the freelist is organized into these sort of blocks which are released in this revision, these and so forth. Mm-hmm. So we just need to note the revision past which through the freelist reuse shouldn't go, and we have that. So it's at this point it's not a lot more work, but it's slightly delicate to clean.
So related, more general question is, Zevian is C++, and crossing this boundary between C++ and C, which is our fault, I guess, but it's also kind of the only sane way to provide shared libraries in Linux. I mean, okay, one could debate in another location whether that's a fair statement.
I'm not sure this is a good moment in time to try and disagree with you on that.
Right, okay, so let's say that...
But in general, I mean, it's certainly hard to provide a stable library API in C++.
Right. So let's suppose that it's not totally insane to want to do this. So make a weaker statement. Then error handling via exceptions is really hard. I mean, so we have a C++ exception that turns into not necessarily the best handled C error in the world, but we're working on it, which then gets passed to Python or Ruby, which throws a language binding specific exception. I don't know. I mean, it's not your problem, but it's a problem for us, I guess, that in this, in where we're gluing Zapier to bindings, and I guess there's probably ways that don't go through C, which are cleaner. I don't know.
I mean, you could just do it via bindings Zapier has. So if you wanted to Python, not much. Essentially, rewrite the parts of the not much C they cared about in Python, which is more work, but then you get a slightly kind of
there's a better semantic match.
Maybe.
I think part of the interesting thing for us has been the many different ways that people have used libnotmuch, and by providing a C library, you kind of can't make that library go away now. Well, we could, but various projects would die if we did.
I think one other option would be, not necessarily that you have to do it, but if it's generally useful, then C wrapper for Zapier that everybody can use, that has C return values, and everybody tries to make sure it does the right thing. I'm not saying we should do that.
I don't know. That's probably so. That's a
for projects that need to deal with it from C. If there are others, are there others?
Well, I don't know how MU is written. I guess it's also in C.
But there are some language bindings people have tried to write where.
C would
be easier.
Yeah. I mean, C is definitely least common denominator, lowest common denominator.
Yeah, sure. I mean, that's.
So,
I mean, that's the.
I wasn't proposing that you had to do it, but
no.
Somebody might want to.
I'll throw that out there in case somebody in the world has a great idea.
I mean, I'm not the biggest fan of exceptions in the world because they are a bit kind of action at a distance. But then checking any. The problem is that any error handling is inherently extra stuff that just confuses the issue.
Yeah.
And it's just a matter of where you push that rather than if it was a magic solution, I think. I think if it's a magic solution, it's going to be a different way of thinking about it rather than. I think it's nice and consistent that you get exceptions out for everything, rather than exceptions out for some things and error codes for others. But it could potentially be done at a wrapper level.
Right. So, I mean, I wouldn't want a mix, but all error codes would somehow be helpful.
Is there any way that, I mean, this is the kind of thing that you could handle with a I'm not saying this would be easier or anything, but if there were some kind of specification for the functions, which exceptions they throw, you might be able to automatically generate a wrapper that does the right thing, and how those exceptions would map to error codes. But I'm sure there's a lot of attendant data that would need to be captured that you couldn't automate, so maybe that doesn't work. I haven't used the interface enough to know.
Unfortunately, there isn't really a very good way to find out what throws what exactly. Because of how exceptions work.
Right, that's why one reason that thing I like about error codes is because it's more likely that everybody's going to document these are the code, or supposed to think that these are the code values that could ever come out of this function.
Mm-hmm.
And exceptions, I think, often, I mean, I use them too in various places, but they encourage, I don't know, let's see what happens.
I went through and tried to add some no accept specifiers, and it's surprising how few things actually can offer an exception. Because there are things like bad alloc, stood bad alloc, which means I couldn't allocate memory.
Mm-hmm.
Almost anything can throw that function down to it.
Yeah.
I don't know much about it. What the bindings do is to refer a standard error handler around everything, or everything. It doesn't get marked as no accept. And then that, what that does is it, in C++ you can call a function from your error handler and then re-throw the error exception in the function. So you don't have to have all that repetitive error handling in line, just in one place at least, which reduces the size of the code generated quite a lot.
Oh, I see. So you generate a wrapper which outsources some of the error handling.
Almost all the error. Basically, the exception handling block just calls function with exception objects.
So one could generate C bindings in the same way as one generates Python.
Yeah,
I mean, bindings.
It was actually work on producing a SWG backend producing C.
Yeah, SWG is, well,
I mean,
it's cool, but I don't want to ever look at that code.
Yeah, that's very true. I mean, it's. The nice thing about SWG is that it automates the process. Once you've told it how to wrap a particular type, it knows how to do that. Which means that you don't end up spending your entire time writing very repetitive stuff just to keep up with API changes. But the downside is that a lot of it's quite hideous in many ways. But I mean, essentially all it really is doing when you come down to it is automating writing the code that you would have had to write by hand. There's not a lot of magic in there, really.
I guess the other pain point for not much users is indexing speed. I don't know, that's kind of a vague complaint, but I mean, most of not much is really fast, even on really large databases. But
hey, don't look at me.
Rob is our official.
Hey, not anymore. I got an SSD, so I'm
supersize my mail store.
Yeah,
but it's the documentary. But indexing is expensive.
Historically, a lot more effort's been expended on the search side than the index side.
Right.
I am currently working on various indexing things on my customers, but it's probably going to be a while before that trickles through.
Well, and I mean, some of it was when I moved to SSD that made a big difference, but. I got the feeling that, I can't really say anything, I'm trying to put my finger on it, but it felt almost like there was some interaction where exactly whatever not much was doing was not, it and the kernel were not very happy about each other.
Yeah, it seemed to be.
Or the file system, I don't know. And I was on Lux too, which, you know, it was a fully encrypted file system on a spinning disk, blah, and I've heard in various places that got an impression that maybe there's something wrong there, or something odd.
There seems to be a case in the kernel. Linux kernel is quite unhappy if you f-sync write a bit of data, f-sync write a bit of data, f-sync write a bit of data, like several times in succession.
Yeah.
It triggers a really kind of unhappy behavior from it.
Is that needed for, I mean, you do that for a reason, I guess, in for atomicity, or is it just historical?
So when the base file is committed, you want to make sure that the base file is there.
Mm-hmm.
So it writes the base file, fsyncs, and renames over. So it doesn't. What it doesn't need to do is to do it in quite that way. What it could do is write them, fsync them, and rename them. I attempted to remove the writes between fsyncs. There's still some, but they're more grouped than they were. With Glass, it should be better because it doesn't have all the base files to fsync, it just has the tables and one file. And in fact, when I get home, I'm going to be working on a single file version of the backend because somebody wants it, which may behave better in this regard, I'm not sure.
So, yeah, I mean,
but
I guess.
They want it for convenience rather than for anything else. But
benchmarking is super hard, and our performance testing suite is really inadequate. So it's more a question of what data is freely available than what models people's workloads will. So it may be also that there are things that can be tuned on the not much side as well.
There's certainly a lot in the indexing kind of workflow that isn't very sensible in terms of, I mean, it, it just uses C++ maps to represent what changes in memory.
Right.
Whereas it could be batching a lot more as it goes, ready to just write out a disk, which will save lots of memory. And it controls when to also graphically flush changes just by counting the number of documents changed in
right.
the scene. No regard for how big those documents are. So you know, if you're indexing Twitter, then the default threshold's 10,000, I think, still,
mm-hmm.
which is probably a bit out of date too. But you know, 10,000 tweets and 10,000 novels is quite a different amount of data. So really, it's also taking more into account of how much data it's using for that.
Does not much use Fmin core?
Did it use?
Not Zapier, well, Zapier too, but do we use, does not much use Fmin core? And this is a whole thing I just went through and bought by the turn. If you're not, and then if you decide to, talk to me because there are some corners there.
Okay.
The way it says it works and the way the Linux kernel actually does is not the same, but the idea of this is that you, when you're doing a traversal, like we're doing, you know, indexing and then saving and in the back thing, you use this to advise the kernel that you're not going to use this thing again.
Oh,
right. Right, but the problem is that the normal call that you would use, like POSIX fadvise, does not do what you want and does not work right. At least, it's another one of those, like you read the man page, what it says it's going to do and what you would guess is not what really happens. Because one of them, there's the no reuse flag, and then there's another one. One of them actually doesn't do anything. It's a no-op in Linux kernel. The other one always ejects it. Like if you say, I'm not going to use this again, it just throws it out like nobody's going to use this again, which is not probably what you meant. But you can use fmin core when you start up to see how much of the data for this file is already in memory. And then once you finish traversing it, only force out the pages that weren't there when you started up. And that's about the best you can do right now. And that can provide a pretty decent performance benefit because it reduces the memory pressure. Because otherwise you're pulling all that into the buffer cache, even though in indexing, you're probably not going to hit it again. So, yeah.
I mean,
it leaves that memory free for Zapian or whoever else. So
yeah,
I'm not saying do it, but I don't want to take up all the time, but it might be interesting.
We use the POSIX fadvise thing in Gmail to stop it keeping everything is red instead of database. But as you say, the problem is what it means is that the thing you've read won't be cached at all.
The method, the mincore trick might help.
I'll hold it up.
Okay,
I've got 10 minutes left.
There are no questions from my side. For a boss, this was a lot of questions for me to ask.
Does anyone else have any questions?
People were just looking.
Oh, it might be worth, I don't know where all this stands, but there was the work that was done on a custom query parser for not much, but then it sounded like you had said there were some features, some of that maybe ought to go into Zapian proper, or could go into Zapian proper. I just wondered if there was anything, because at some point I might poke around there, I'm not promising, but so I was curious.
I mean, there's been some talk and not much, quite I think I'm suffering a cold this week. There's been talking not much for a while about the custom query parser for supporting various things. I kind of feel that there isn't anything not much wants which shouldn't really be possible to do with Zapkins. I mean, it isn't possible at the moment, but it ought to be flexible enough to do that. And so extending Zapkins parser to support these features
would be better.
Seems the better approach to me, because then everyone benefits.
Yeah.
So that was all I was trying to say when I said that, really. But the problem is that not much seems to be quite conservative about what better tabulation it would accept. Which, I mean, to some extent is reasonable, but...
Well, we want to be able to run in Debian stable to bring it back to Debian.
I mean, but if it works in Debian stable, it works better if you have a newer version.
I think that's, and that's fine. And I think part of what we have over the last couple releases accomplished is having a much more fine-grained view of what sort of features a given not much configuration supports.
Mm-hmm.
So this makes it, you can, we we may be in a better position to do that. But yeah, I mean, I think graceful degradation with older versions totally makes sense to me. And I mean, we have, you know, there's a configuration, right? We can,
yeah,
we can do these things. So.
Right.
And I also think, given the history of lots of talk but not actually a lot of code, that doing things incrementally in Zapian makes sense, in the sense that here's a feature that we'd like in not much, rather than the grand new query parser, which is still
it's easier to get some incremental feature parser of architecture committee.
Yeah.
Yes.
Safety problem.
And perhaps a contributing factor to that is that it's well past time we have a new second stable release series.
Yes.
it seems to be basically I'm very busy and release management isn't something that anyone actually pays for, so
right.
It tends to get a bit I'll do that next week. So, but I'm definitely trying to push towards it. I'm hoping this year.
Where's the best place to get started? Is it, I mean, if you want to start, I haven't even looked at the documentation yet, so presumably the documentation.
So yeah, there's quite a good kind of book to collaborate about, and there's several documentation sprints for getting started with Zapping.
Okay.
Which really ought to replace most of the other documentation we're doing around it.
Right.
To sort of integrate into it, so yeah.
Right.
That's definitely better than most of the existing documentation.
Is there anything else anyone wanted to? Because I think we have 5 minutes.
Yep.
I suggest we wrap up and
right.
Go and see if his coffee is really
coffee. All right. Well, thanks a lot, Ollie. Thanks for all
your
work.
Thanks for coming.
And thanks for.